Nanabhai Ardeshir Palkhivala was born on 16th January 1920, the second of three children. His surname, like many Parsi surnames, was based on the business carried on by his ancestors. The Palkhivalas manufactured palkis or palanquins. His parents, Ardeshir and Shiru, were a devoted couple. A later day edition of Palkhivala's classic commentary, The Law and Practice of Income Tax, was dedicated to the memory of his parents with these memorable words: "To the memory of my father and mother, so now in the end, if this the least be good, if any deed be done, if any fire burn in the imperfect page, the praise be thine." If ever a colossus strode across the Indian legal arena, it was Nani Palkhivala. After a brilliant academic career, he quickly became one of India's most sought-after lawyers and remained at center stage for five decades. Famous for his phenomenal power of concentration and persuasive advocacy, he was a supremely successful lawyer. Palkhivala Foundation was conceived in the year 2003 after the demise of the legendary lawyer Palkhivala. A few like-minded professionals in Chennai who were regular in attending his famous budget speeches got together and decided to form a trust to perpetuate the memory of late Nani Palkhivala. The main objective of the trust is to conduct public lectures on subjects covering various issues of national and public importance. Palkhivala had a great regard for the intelligentsia of Madras, as Chennai was then called, and had mentioned this more than once in his budget speeches. The trust has been conducting these lectures since February 2003, when it was formally inaugurated by Mr. A. Sivasailam, and the first inaugural lecture was delivered by Mr. Soli Surabji. We present you this short clip on some of the activities of the foundation.
In expounding the subject in court was matched by his genius in explaining the intricacies of the budget to thousands of his listeners. His famous annual budget speech, Humble Beginnings, it started in 1958 in a small hotel called Green Hotel that was next to the Taj Mahal, if you know Bombay, any one of you. He spoke without notes, read off facts and figures from memory for over an hour, keeping his audience in rapt attention. Mr. Prashant, I'm sorry, I do not believe in the theory of reincarnation. But if I did, I'm sure Lord Macaulay was reincarnated in Nani Palkhivala as far as his memory is concerned. The audience in these meetings, the audience was drawn from industrialists, lawyers, businessmen, chartered accountants, and also the corporate. Nani's speeches were fascinating for their brevity and clarity. His budget speeches became so popular throughout India, and the audience for them grew so large that bigger halls and later the Brahman Stadium, where we used to play our matches, Brahman Stadium in Bombay had to be booked to keep pace with the demand of an audience of nearly 50,000. It was aptly said that in those days, there were two budget speeches. One by the finance minister, and another by Nani Palkhivala. And Nani Palkhivala's speech was undoubtedly the more popular and more sought after. I think it was a phenomenon which could only come from a genius in the art of communicating. Palkhivala had deep respect, indeed reverence, for the Constitution. He realized the importance of preserving the cardinal values of the Constitution, its basic and essential features. His favorite quotation was the statement of Joseph Story, the great American jurist, who said, and I quote, and the words are worth remembering, "The Constitution has been reared for immortality if the work of man may justly aspire to such a title. It may nevertheless perish in an hour by the folly or corruption or negligence of its only keepers, the peoples." Palkhiwala believed that a constitution is intended not merely to provide for the exigencies of the moment, but to endure over the ages. He urged that we should get accustomed to a spacious view of the great instrument because, to quote his words, "the constitution was meant to impart such a momentum to the living spirit of the rule of law that democracy and civil liberty may survive in India beyond our times and in the days when our place will know us no more." Palkhiwala was offered judgeship of the Supreme Court in early 40s. He was born in 1920, which he declined, possibly for the same reasons which made him decline the office of the Attorney General for India. "I wish destiny or some other force could have made Nani decline the office of directorship in the excellent House of Tatas, because he gave up a lot of his time and energy to that excellent business house, but he could have devoted that to the legal profession and its reform of the legal system." There was one point on which Nani and I always had discussions and some differences. Palkhiwala has received recognition from renowned academics. In the book Writing a Democratic Constitution by the eminent Granville Austen, the reference to Palkhiwala occurs at 16 pages. Palkhiwala received citations and honorary degrees of Doctor of Laws from various universities such as Princeton University, Lawrence University, Annamalai University, Tamil Nadu University, and of course the University of Bombay. The citation he received from Princeton University is worth reproducing as it epitomizes Nani's basic qualities. Let me read it to you. The citation says, "Defender of constitutional liberties, champion of human rights, has courageously advanced his conviction that expediency in the name of progress at the cost of freedom is no progress at all, but retrogression. Lawyer, teacher, author, and economic developer, he brings to us, as ambassador of India, intelligence, good humor, experience, and vision for international understanding." Very few can aspire to have such a citation. Now, all these attainments to which I have referred testify to Palkhiwala's brilliance, his eminence, his versatility, his phenomenal memory. But the quality of greatness which we rightly attribute to him lay in his basic human qualities. The foremost was his willingness to help persons in need without any show of publicity. Let me recount one instance which all of you may be well aware of. Dr. Madina, of the famous Shankar Netranar Hospital in Chennai, was invited for dinner at his home by Nani. After dinner was over, Nani escorted a doctor to his car and gave him a small envelope saying that this was a token contribution for the hospital. When Dr. Badrinath later opened the envelope, he found it in Nani's personal check for rupees 2 crores, a token contribution. Let me recount another instance. As a tribute to Jayaprakash Narayan, who played an outstanding role in regaining freedom for India after the nightmare of emergency, Palkhiwala founded the Jayaprakash Institute of Human Freedoms. The purpose of the institute is to strengthen the roots of Indian democracy and to carry on the epoch-making work of that great patriot. A sum of ₹5,37,000, representing the proceeds of the profit from Palkhiwala's 7th edition of the Law and Practice of Income Tax, was entirely donated to that institute. How many know about it? He never trumpeted that, he never made a show of it. Sri Aurobindo was his favorite writer and thinker, whose writings greatly attracted him. I think Nani really is the concept of plain living and high thinking. Success did not go to his head. Fame and fortune did not increase the hat size of the legendary Nani Palkhivala. There was never a trace of arrogance or conceit or pomposity in him. Another outstanding human quality about Nani was that jealousy, or rather envy, the besetting sin, which cannot countenance the fame and success of others, it that never consumed him. Holier than thou attitude, which we find very often, was alien to him. He was not the one to smile and shake your hand and thereafter stab you in the back. Backbiting and denigration of others was unknown to him. Humility and natural modesty were his hallmarks. He had no ego problems, as you heard. The warmth of his friendship extended to all fellow human beings, whatever the station in life. He was tender towards the bashful, gentle towards the distant, and merciful towards Nani Palkhivala fulfilled Newman's definition of a true gentleman to the hilt.